Yeah, well, the philosophy is it's very specific and unique. There have been 10 Halloween movies, and I think the 11th one is coming out now. I think we're about to be the highest grossing Halloween of all time. And one of the reasons I wanted to do Halloween is to see if my system would work on a franchise that's been around for 10 movies. And basically, it aligns interests. So we take the actors, the writer, the director. None of us take a fee. And if the movies don't work, no one gets paid, or they get paid the minimum you're allowed to pay by scale. And if the movies do work, you get a check. And sometimes you get a very big check, and we've paid out a lot of money over the years, so we have a relatively easy time getting people to roll the dice on their own work. A funny thing is the way I deliver the checks myself to FedEx. I take a little video of myself, and then I send the video of me sending the check to the actor. The checks are based on box office, so that there's no fuzzy Hollywood accounting. We do what we say we're gonna do, and it's taken a while, but it seems to be working.
Sounds like a reasonable model. Jason, it feels like we're in sort of a bull market for horror films, partly because of what you're doing and some of the success you've had. Why do you think we're seeing this moment of popularity?
Well, I think the theatrical market is really changing, and it's the middle, the definition of the middle is growing bigger. And what I mean by that is that the budgets are either $100 million and over or $15 million and under. And those middle budget levels, that sort of work has migrated to television and streamers. And I think one of the reasons that horror is so robust is because it's one of the few genres left that people feel the need to go see in a theater. And the truth is, you cannot appreciate a horror movie nearly as much at home as you can in a big, dark room full of people. And so it's keeping the theatrical experience vibrant, and it keeps people going to movie theaters.
Jason, it's Evan Newmark. Regarding Halloween, I assumed somebody had the rights to the Halloween franchise along the way. How did you get the rights for them to participate in this micro-budget model when you would normally have expected the Halloween franchise to be so incredibly expensive to begin with?
Well, that's a great question. And one of the ways I pursued it for a long time with a lot of passion. And my pitch I made to the rights holders in the same way that I made earlier in my remarks, which is that I really thought that the franchise could really benefit from a new way to approach the movies. And one of the key things I did is I believe that you should not make subsequent movies to the original movie without involving the original people. And that, for horror movies, is particularly unusual. And so one of the things I did is I said, I don't want to make Halloween unless we can get John Carpenter back. And they said, you're never going to get him back. We've tried. And I said, you know, I really want to give it a try. And I said to John, you know, they're going to make the movie with or without us. I'm not going to make it without you. So if you say no, we're not going to do it. But why don't, instead of, he has not liked a lot of the Halloween movies. And I said, why not, instead of complaining about it, let's get together and try and make it great. And we got John and we got Jamie Lee Curtis. And I think one of the reasons the movie works is we combined them with David Gordon Green and Danny McBride. So the old voice and the new voice came together to make a new Halloween.